Today I want to talk with you about three major goals for the church. We could have called them the goals that Paul established as we read the book of Colossians. The book of Colossians is an outstanding book. But I went on and labeled them because they are goals for the church, not just goals that Paul set, but that Paul set through the knowledge of the Holy Spirit. And perhaps the most quoted verse in Paul's letter to the Colossians is one that you and I know, Christ in you, the hope of glory. But that's not the one we're going to today. Because in this letter, we're inspired and Paul exhorts us to grab hold of the power of what it really means to have received the indwelling Christ in your life when you were born again. He wants you to understand what you have. And in order for you to understand that, you can't just, you know, never pick up your Bible or come to church just once every blue moon. You know, the Bible, this is your manual for life and how to live in these days that we are the fourth runner. We are the last runner. There are none behind us. And so we must run a very good race. The ones behind us are the tribulation saints. They are the ones who's coming behind us. This letter, the Colossians, he wrote it from prison, an environment that in itself does not offer much hope, you know that, but in which nevertheless Paul took great encouragement and even comfort from the awareness that he was not alone in prison, that the indwelling Jesus Christ was with him and never left him, never would leave him. How real Jesus was to him as he was in that prison. Of all Paul's letters, this one, Colossians, the book of Colossians, speaks more about the importance of Jesus Christ than any of the other books. Of all Paul's letter, too, and in this letter, we get a unique glimpse of Paul's heart and what he feels about the early church. And as he sits there in prison, what's going through his mind, what he's praying about, the things he's struggling with, and what is of utmost importance to him as he's in this barbaric prison, as he is there. Let's go to Colossians chapter 2. For I want you to know how great a struggle I have for you and for those at Laodicea, and for all who have not seen me face to face. That their hearts may be encouraged, being knit together in love to reach all the riches of full assurance of understanding and the knowledge of God's mystery, which is Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and of knowledge. I say this in order that no one may delude you with plausible arguments. For though I am absent in body, yet I am with you in spirit, rejoicing to see your good order and the firmness of your faith in Christ. Now again, you probably expected me to quote some of the other outstanding verses in Colossians, but it's these five verses, Colossians 2, 1 through 5 that I just read, these five verses that you're going to discover what's in Paul's mind, what he's going through as he's sat in prison, thinking about the church. He wrote to the Colossians about what really, really was important. And it's very important that we hear this. So the word struggle in Greek means to agonize, to exert, to contend. So in this particular context, it refers not only to Paul's difficult journeys that he had, the tireless preaching that he did, the duty that he had of taking care of all of the churches that he established here, there, and yonder. But it also talks about the passionate intercession that he had for each disciple and for each person in the church. Nothing mattered more to Paul than that new believers would be established disciples and grounded in the Lord. Paul literally agonized over them. He exerted himself for them. He contended for the truth of the gospel to impact them to the very core of their being. He wanted them to meet Jesus the way he met Jesus. He wanted them to respond to Jesus the way he responded to Jesus. He wanted them to let go of themselves in order that Christ could live through them. And he was still in a cold, dark dungeon, still saying the same things, hoping that they would see the all-sufficiency of the Lord Jesus Christ. So Paul was deeply aware that the Lord can turn everything around for good. So he eagerly wanted the Colossians to benefit from his imprisonment. It's as if he's saying, get your focus off the fact that I'm a prisoner and instead learn something from it for yourselves. Amen. Let my sufferings inspire you to suffer for the Lord if need be. Let my sufferings motivate you to a deeper walk with Jesus. Yes. He said, yes, I'm suffering, but my heart's desire is that you profit from my sufferings. His struggles was for the church to be the church. He wanted to see every believer on fire for the Lord God Almighty. Look at Colossians 1, 27 through 29. To them God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are the riches of the glory of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Him we proclaim, warning everyone and teaching everyone with all wisdom, that we may present everyone mature in Christ. For this I toil, he's saying, struggling with all his energy, that he powerfully works within me. Knowing that Christ is in you brings you to an awakening of eternal life. Whether you like it or not, everybody's watching.
Come on.
Everybody's watching. Let them see that Jesus brought me out. His dedication to and love for the church was so great that in his worst sufferings, Paul was not crying out for deliverance from prison, but instead that the church should be blessed from what he was going through, learn from what he was going through, that they would see that he did not crumble, he did not crash land, he did not walk away from God, he was still faithful to God. He knew that his God had not changed in the difficulty.
Amen.
See, we must be constantly progressing and maturing in the things of the Lord. What an amazing perspective Paul had. What a selfish attitude. What was Paul thinking then in these verses? Three things, there are three goals that Paul wanted for the Colossians or for the church. One, he wanted their hearts to be encouraged. You'll find them all in those first five verses. Number two, he wanted them to be knit together in love. I call it, we must be tight.
Amen.
I've said it over and over and over again. It will be the making of your victory. Number three, he wanted them to have full assurance of their position in Christ, to be absolutely sure of what they know, not just have head knowledge. To the Thessalonians, Paul wrote in 1 Thessalonians 5:11, Therefore, encourage one another and build one another up just as you are doing. Encourage each other. Don't pull each other down. You're going to make it. There is not a force in all the world bigger than the Christ that's in you.
Amen.
He is your hope of the glory that you live here and you will see there.
Amen.
He's in you. You carry him.
Right.
You carry him wherever you may go. You carry him. Give support. Look at Hebrews 10:24. And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, church, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. The day is drawing near. We need to be found in church as much as possible. I know some can't. But I know a whole bunch can that are not here.
All right.
Or if you don't want to come here, go somewhere.
Amen.
Where they're teaching the Word of God, where they believe in the cross of Calvary, where they know the cleansing power of the blood of Jesus. Romans 1, for I long to see you, that I may impart to you some spiritual gift to strengthen you. That is, that we may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith. Both yours and mine. Let me give you a real deep truth, church. We all get discouraged at one time or another. We think our discouragement comes from situations, from people, or from disappointments. But let me give you the nugget the Lord gave me. We get discouraged when we get our eyes off of Jesus. That is the fundamental reason for discouragement.
Amen.
There is a place where you can find peace in every situation, answers to your problems, and wisdom beyond measure. Sandra's 3-CD series reveals valuable keys of how to pursue and maintain the prevailing life God intended for us to have in the days ahead. Also included is her audiobook, Preparations for a Move of God, which teaches how to move out of hope by walking in faith, not by sight. Call or visit our website so you can begin to apply these keys to your life.
One of the most vital ministries that you can do, and every person can do it, is the ministry of encouragement.
Amen.
Encouragement. Being an encourager doesn't come naturally for some people, but for a believer, it's not an option.
Right.
And the best way to receive encouragement is to give it.
Amen.
Be an encourager. Proverbs 12:25 says, worry weighs a person down. An encouraging word cheers a person up.
Yes.
If you're discouraged where there's no one around to encourage you, do what David did. 1 Samuel 30. And David was greatly distressed, for the people spake of stoning him. Yeah, I believe I'd be upset. Because the soul of all the people was grieved, every man for his sons and his daughters. But David encouraged himself in the Lord his God.
Amen.
Number two, Paul longed for believers to be knit together in love. Be tight with each other. He wanted his struggling to motivate the church to grow in deep love, authentic love to each other. What does that look like? Like a group of people who've grown out of selfishness and matured into selflessness.
Amen.
Ephesians 2:3-4. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only into his own interests, but also to the interests of others. He said, for a body of believers to be knit together in love is no small calling, church.
Amen.
It's far more than sloppy agape. People are people. They are, saved and unsaved.
That's right.
He's simply asking for a simple act of obedience. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. Jesus put it this way in John 13. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another, just as I've loved you, you also are to love one another. Has Jesus been kind to you when you didn't deserve it?
Yes.
Has Jesus been patient with you, merciful to you, long-suffering with you? Yes. Has he been faithful to you?
Yes.
He says, as I've loved you, you're to love one another. It has everything to do with growing into the image and likeness of the Lord Jesus Christ. I don't know about you, but I want to grow in the likeness of the Lord Jesus Christ. Peter summarized it this way in 1 Peter 4:8. Above all, keep loving one another earnestly, since love covers a multitude of sins. Number three, Paul longed that believers would reach full assurance of understanding and wisdom. The assurance of your salvation is essential to your growth in the Lord Jesus Christ. If you are not assured, you're not going to grow in him.
Amen.
We lose the assurance when we refuse to forgive ourselves.
Amen.
When we continue to focus on past sins,
Amen.
You will lose the assurance of your salvation. He wants us to be utterly and completely assured that there's a place in heaven reserved for you. Your name's on it. It was prepared by Jesus just for you. And that's what he said he would do. You know, if there's anybody in the whole New Testament who could struggle with their salvation, it was Peter. I mean, he denied the Lord three times, and he lived with the Lord for 3 years. Yet it's that very same Peter who wrote 2 Peter 1:3. By his divine power, God has given us everything we need for living a godly life. We've received all of this by coming to know him. How do you get it? Knowing him. The one who called us to himself by means of his marvelous glory and excellence. We've adopted this strange notion that, I do thank Jesus for saving me. I mean, I really do. But I still got to work hard to keep it so that when I sin, my assurance goes out the door. Nowhere in the scriptures does it say once you're born again, you will never sin. Where does it say that? It says you don't have to sin. But it never says you won't sin. Oh, my goodness. That's why 1 John is here. That's what he put it here for. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. And the truth is not in us. If we confess our sin, he's faithful just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But God is a forgiving God, and with each forgiveness, as you grow in his grace, you will go longer the next time before it happens again. That's the goodness of God. We weren't saved by works. We don't stay saved by works, but by the incomparable grace and faithfulness of God Almighty. Jesus commanded us to bear fruit. That's your works, it's fruit. But when you're hooked into the tree, you don't even make that happen. Now, if you've been saying you know Jesus and you still... nothing about you has changed. Let me say something to you. You don't know him. You do not know him. You don't know him. Unless you're changed. See, our problem is that we're more convinced how we are convinced of how we see ourselves than we are about how God sees us. We think we carry more weight than God does. Do you understand that the prodigal son never stopped being the son of the father?
Right.
Though he strayed away and wasted time on foolish pursuits, he still was the father's son.
Right.
That's a message unto itself.
Yes, it is.
Now listen, we've all done stupid things. Yes, you. I'm talking to you. Made decision we regretted. Said things we wish he'd never said.
Yes.
Not walking and talking like blood-bought, washed saints of the living God. But Jude said, now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy. Ooh. To the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Ooh. If you lack full assurance of your salvation, it's for one or three reasons. Did you get it? If you're having trouble and you lack assurance, it's one of these three reasons is why you're having the struggle. Number one, ignorance of the Word of God.
Amen.
You don't know what God has said about you as a born-again believer. You don't know. You're just ignorant of what God has said and done and what he's done for you. Number two, unbelief regarding the Word. You know what he says, but you don't believe it about yourself.
Amen.
Number three, deception. You accept the devil's lie that you're, quote, not worthy. Here's what full assurance looks like, Romans. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loves us. I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. That is a shout if ever there was one. Glory to God! Thank you, Jesus. In that second chapter of Colossians, Paul declares that all the wisdom, all the knowledge, all the understanding we will ever need is contained in Christ. Everything. All wisdom, all knowledge, all understanding, all of it is found in Christ Jesus. There's no need to look anywhere else. Don't let anyone ever cause you to stray through deceptive ideas and man-generated theories.
Yeah.
Hold firmly to Jesus, who is the way, the truth, and the life.
Yeah.
In verse 5, he commends the Colossian church for maintaining good order. Though he had not been there, it's obvious that Paul had received a good report about how that church functioned, and he'd been told that they were firm in the faith, unmoved by false teachers who'd crept in. At the end of the book, he addresses false teachers. He gives a thorough rebuttal of false teachings at the end of the book. But in this earliest part of his letter, what is heavy on his heart are the three issues we have been talking about. Let me give them to you again. Number one, that the church be encouraged and give encouragement. Number two, that they be knit together in love. Be tight with each other. Number three, that every disciple would be fully assured of what Jesus has provided for us through his sacrificial life, death, and resurrection. To believe the Word of God.
Amen.
To believe if he said it, he will do it. He is not a man that he should lie. The Bible says he cannot lie. Not will, not cannot. He cannot lie. So when the enemy of your own flesh tries to discourage or demoralize you, Remember what Jude, one of the Lord's brothers, declared. Let's go back to Jude. Now to him who is able to keep you, it's Jesus who's going to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and forever. In Colossians, the first chapter, it says this: we stand before him holy and blameless without a single fault.
Amen.
Wow.
Amen.
Wow.
Amen.
Without a single, the Lord sees us without a single fault. Is that not amazing? Wow. Glory to his holy name. Lord, teach us to be encouragers. Teach us to be faithful to your word. Teach us to believe what you said about us and give us courage to walk in it when we don't feel it.
Amen.
But to know it's true, whether we feel it or not, that we walk in it. Help us to care about each other, to be tight with each other, to care. And let us be fully assured,
Amen,
Jesus is coming.
Amen.
He's not going to leave me behind.
Amen.
He's not going to leave you behind. If you belong to him, you've given your life to him, you invited him into your heart, you've been changed by the power of the gospel, and you belong to him, and you are in the process of becoming totally mature in him and growing into his likeness, he's not going to leave you. He's coming. And if we should go by the way of the grave, we will meet him face to face. However it might be, quickly, face to face, we shall see him in all of his glory. And he will not know. No need to open your mouth and say, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. Say it now, and he will. There will be nothing that he knows about you except goodness, wonderful things, forgiveness, blameless, not one sin in your life. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord God Almighty. Glory to God.
There is a place where you can find peace in every situation, answers to your problems, and wisdom beyond measure. Sandra's 3-CD series reveals valuable keys of how to pursue and maintain the prevailing life God intended for us to have in the days ahead. Also included is her audiobook, Preparations for a Move of God, which teaches how to move out of hope by walking in faith, not by sight. Call or visit our website so you can begin to apply these keys to your life.